السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. In the hadith of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiyallahu anhu wa ardah, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. And the hadith is muttafaqun alayh. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, in the body there is a morsel of flesh, and if this morsel of flesh is good and rectified, then the entire body will be good. But if this morsel of flesh has become corrupted, then the entire body will become corrupted. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that this is the heart. And in the hadith of Hudhayfa, radiyallahu anhu wa arda, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, تُعْرَدُ الْفِتَنُ عَلَى الْقُلُوبِ كَعَرْضِ الْحَصِيرِ عُودًا عُودًا. That the temptations will be presented to the hearts of people, just like you have a straw mat which is woven stick by stick. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, فَأَيُّ قَلْبٍ أُشْرِبَهَا نُكِتَتْ فِيهِ نُكْتَةٌ سَوْدًا. So whichever heart accepts these temptations and allows these temptations to enter it, then a black dot will be placed on the heart. وَأَيُّ قَلْبٍ أَنْكَرَهَا نُكِتَتْ فِيهِ نُكْتَةٌ بَيْضًا. And whichever heart repels this and refuses to accept this temptation, then a white dot will be placed within this heart. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, حَتَّى تَعُودَ الْقُلُوبَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبَيْنِ. Until there will be two different types of heart. قَلْبٍ أَسْوَدٍ مُرْبَادًا كَالْكُوزِ مُجَخِّيًا لَا يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُ مُنْكَرًا. That there will be a black heart, which will be like the color of dust. And this will be like a tilted cup. It will not accept any good, and it will not repel any evil, except that which it desires. Like if we had a cup and it was tilted like this, and we wanted to put water inside the cup, what would happen? It would leave the cup. So this is how that heart would become. It would become like a tilted cup, that any good deed that came to it, it would repel it, and nothing will be able to enter this heart. And the second type of heart mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, وَقَلْبٍ أَبْيَضٍ لَا تَضُرُّهُ فِتْنَةٌ مَا دَامَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. That the second heart will be a white heart, and no temptation will ever be able to affect this heart as long as the heavens and the earth are in its place. So this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informs us that there are two different types of hearts. The first heart is a dark heart, that which allows the temptations to come to it, and that which doesn't repel it. So a black dot is placed on that heart. Then a second temptation will come, and another black dot will be placed on that heart, until the entire heart becomes dark, and there is no goodness left in this person, to the extent that if any goodness would come to it, it will repel it instantly, and it would not accept anything from the Qur'an, or anything from the Sunnah, or anything from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the first type of heart. And the second heart is the heart of the believer. That when goodness comes, when a temptation comes to this heart, it turns away from it, and it doesn't accept this temptation. And when goodness comes to this heart, it accepts it. Every time it turns away from temptation, a white dot is placed on the heart. And then the next temptation comes, and he turns away from it. So another white dot is placed on the heart, until the entire heart becomes white. And this person is the true believer, the one who stays away from the temptations, the one who enjoins in the good and forbids the evil. And this is the heart that inshallah ta'ala we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows us to have a heart like this. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran that shaytan, He says, ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. That shaytan, He says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I will come to them, meaning the believers, meaning the Muslims, I will come to them from in front of them and from behind them, from their rights and from their left. And you will find most of them unthankful to you. Most of them will be ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So shaytan, he knows about the heart of the slave. And he knows that this heart is that which controls the entire body. And if he is able to take control of this heart, he will take control of the entire body. So he doesn't need to tempt us by things that do not affect our heart. He goes directly to our heart. Like if a person now was in an army and he's fighting the enemy, what is he going to be told? He said, if you take out the leader of the enemy, the one who gives the instructions, the one who commands, the one who prohibits, then the people will not be able to do anything. They would not know what to do. Why? Because who do they follow now? Who is going to command them? So you go for the leader of the army. And the leader of the body is the heart. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, if this heart is rectified, the entire body will be like this. And if the heart becomes corrupt, then the entire body would become corrupt. So Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, the first thing that shaitan will attack you through is your heart. And he will try and destroy your heart. He doesn't need to tell you about anything else. He just goes straight to your heart. And once he takes control of your heart, you have nothing left. And you become a disbeliever. That's why Allah, in this ayah, he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that most of them will not be thankful to you. And that's why we find most of the people are not Muslims. And even from amongst the Muslims, how many Muslims are actually practicing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands? And that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commands. So shaitan, he attacks us from every different direction. He mentioned four different directions. And he didn't mention six different directions. He mentioned in front of us and from behind us, from our rights and from our left. But he didn't mention from above us or from beneath us. Now it's mentioned in the tafsir that he didn't mention from above us because this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And he didn't mention from beneath us because this is where we do sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he was commanded to make sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was from those that were unable to make sujood. So he cannot attack us from the direction of sujood. This is why we find the believers who increase in their sujood, they are those who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So increasing in sujood is one of the things that brings us a lot closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it allows our dua. It's a time where a person can make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he is in sajda, and it is a way that he can purify his heart from all diseases. Now the topic today is about illicit love, about a type of love which is haram, a type of relationship which is haram, a type of look which is haram, a type of touch and a type of walking, and also a type of thinking which is haram. And this is all of this revolves around zina. All of this revolves around adultery and fornication. And this, after committing, associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and killing, is the worst sin. As Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that zina, that adultery is a reason for people's lineage to be destroyed. It is one of the things that cause corruption on earth. It is a reason for people to kill each other and have enmity towards each other because of zina. If someone commits zina with someone's sister or their mother or their daughter or their wife, then this becomes a reason for them to kill someone or for them to attack someone or have great enmity towards that person. So after killing, it is the worst deed. It is the worst sin. And Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَلَا أَعْلَمُ بَعْدَ قَتْلِ النَّفْسِ شَيْئًا أَعْظَمُ مِنَ الزِّنَى. I do not know anything after killing an innocent soul, something that is worse than zina. Because zina is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has warned the believers against. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned the believers against this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرٍ. Those who do not, he's mentioning the characteristics of the believer. And he says, those who do not associate any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. And they do not kill any innocent soul that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not allowed them to kill. وَلَا يَزْنُونَ. And they do not commit adultery. They do not commit zina. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions zina after killing. and he mentions killing after the shirk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا, that do not come close to zina. إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا, that this is a great transgression and this is an evil path that a person takes. He didn't say do not commit zina. He said do not come close to zina. Do not do anything that leads to zina. Because everything that leads to zina is haram. Everything that leads to haram is haram. And everything that leads to halal is halal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا, do not come close to zina. Stay away from everything that leads to zina. And zina is not something, adultery and fornication is not something which is just haram for humans, for the children of Adam alayhi salam. But this is also something which is haram even upon the animals. And there's a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, from the hadith of Amr ibn Maymun radiallahu an, he said, رَأَيْتُ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ قِرْدًا زَنَى بِقِرْدًا. Before Islam, I saw a monkey that committed zina with another monkey. فَاجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِمَا الْقُرُودِ. So all of the monkeys, they got together. فَرَجَمُوهُمَا حَتَّى مَاتَ. So, and they killed, then they stoned these two monkeys until they died. And then this sahabi radiallahu anhu, he says, وَكُنْتُ فِي مَنْ رَجَمَهَا. And I was from those who also stoned the monkey. So I saw the monkeys doing this and I knew this was an evil action. So I did this as well. And the hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. The hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. So not is it something, not, it's not just in our eyes that we find zina to be something disgusting and something haram. But even the animals find this to be something disgusting and something haram. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he warned us of zina. And he warned us of the fitna of the temptations that the opposite gender they bring towards us. And he says in the hadith of Usama radiallahu an, in Sahih al-Bukhari and also in Sahih Muslim, مَا تَرَكْتُ بَعْدِي فِتْنَةً أَدَرَّ عَلَى الرِّجَالِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. I haven't left any temptation behind me which is more harmful upon the men than women. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, I haven't left, there isn't any fitna that you will find that is more harmful to men than women. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in another hadith, فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَاءِ, that fear the dunya and fear the temptations of women, because this will destroy us. The temptations of women will destroy the men. And there are many hadith and many stories from amongst the Salaf where they will inform us that the temptations of women have destroyed their people. And this is something that we can see even today. How many people have changed their religions because of a woman that they like? How many people leave the salah because of a woman that they like? And they leave the zakah and they leave the siyam. That they find that they become and they enter a relationship with a woman. And she says, how can you go to a masjid? So he leaves the masjid. How can you fast? So he leaves fasting. How can you give money to those people? So he leaves the charity. How can you be a Muslim? So he leaves his religion. And this is something which we find is common, not in just this day and age, but also from the people that came before us. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he warns us of this disease of the heart. And this is this love of the opposite gender that we are not allowed to have. Not just the love, but when a person, it all begins with looking at the opposite gender. Because when a person hasn't looked at someone, then he cannot love someone. He cannot know that person. He will not be able to fancy her and his heart will not be inclined towards her. So the first haram is the gaze. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقْ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. That doesn't the one who has created know his creation? He is the most gentle subhanahu wa ta'ala and he is the all aware of his creation. Doesn't he subhanahu wa ta'ala know his creation? He is the one who made us subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who created us. He knows exactly how our heart works and how our minds work. So he subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the cure for every disease. And for this disease, he subhanahu wa ta'ala say, he says in the Quran, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. That tell the believing men to lower their gazes and to guide and to guard their private parts. And he says about the women, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنْ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنْ. And tell the believing women to lower their gazes and to guard their private parts. The first thing a person does is that he looks, he raises his gaze and he looks at the opposite gender. Then this leads to a desire in the heart. Then this leads to an action that he takes to go towards that and fulfill that desire. And then this leads to fulfilling that desire. And fulfilling that desire leads to Jahannam, leads to the fire that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared. And this has been mentioned by Ibn al-Qayyim in Ad-Da'a wa Ad-Dawa, in the poison and the cure. He says the first thing a person does is that he raises his gaze and he looks at the opposite gender. And this is the first haram. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. Lower your gazes. Because this is the first haram that a person can do with the opposite gender, is to look at them. And then this would lead to a desire in the heart. So he begins to think about this person. And he begins to think about what he can do with this person. Then this leads to him walking towards this person, either following her, or going to her house, or beginning a conversation with her, or sending something to a text message, or an email. And then this will lead to her, him having direct contact with her. And this will lead to him committing zina with her. And this will lead to him entering Jahannam and being punished for the action that he has done. How did it begin? From him not lowering his gaze. So in this ayah, if you contemplate this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. Tell the believing men to lower their gazes and to guard their private parts. What is the bare minimum action you can do with the opposite gender? It's to look at them. And what is the maximum haram you can do with them? It's to commit zina with them. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he prohibits the bare minimum thing we can do with the opposite gender, which is to look. And he prohibits the worst thing we can do with the opposite gender, which is zina. Which means everything between the two are haram. If looking is haram and this is the bare minimum, and zina is haram and this is the maximum, everything between the two is haram. Touching the hand is haram. Shaking the hands is haram. Hugging is haram. Talking in a desirable manner is haram. All of this is haram. And this ayah is the proof. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made everything the bare minimum haram and the maximum haram. So everything between the two are haram. Now in the hadith, in the musnad of Imam Ahmad, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, النَظْرَةُ سَحْمٌ مَسْمُومٌ مِنْ سِهَامِ إِبْلِيسِ. That looking at a woman is an arrow from the poison arrows of Iblis. Looking at a woman is an arrow from the poison arrows of Iblis, of Shaytan. فَمَنْ غَدَّ بَصَرَهُ عَنْ مَحَاسِنِ امْرَأَةٍ لِلَّهِ أَوْرَثَ اللَّهُ قَلْبَهُ حَلَاوَةً إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ يَلْقَاهُ. So whoever lowers his gaze from something that he sees that appeals to him from a woman for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fill his heart with delight until he meets him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Looking at a woman is an arrow from the poison arrows of shaitan. This is a way that shaitan, he is able to take over our hearts. He will allow you to look once, and then it's only one look. He'll allow you to look once with desire. And you see this woman with desire, and he'll make you think about this woman day and night until it makes you crazy. And once this happens, a person, he goes out looking for zina until his desires have become satisfied. This is how the shaitan works. It only takes one look. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that if you look, as soon as you see the woman, you lower your gaze. The first look, which you didn't intend, is halal. But as soon as you see that haram, you lower your gaze instantly. Because the second look, or the continuation of that first look, is haram. And this is that which leads to zina. When we look at the opposite gender, this would trigger the desire in the man. Because shaitan is working with his enemies against us. And this is how he tempts us to commit zina. And this is how he tempts us to leave the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith of Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the Sahihain, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, كُتِبَ عَلَى ابْنِ آدَمْ نَصِيبُهُ مِنَ الزِّنَى. That the children of Adam, it is written that how much zina they would commit. مُدْرِكٌ ذَلِكَ لَا مَحَالَ. And they would find that they would do this, and there is no stopping them from doing this. فَالْعَيْنَانِ زِنَاهُمَ النَّظَرِ. As for the two eyes, their zina, their fornication, is the gaze, is looking. وَالْأُذُنَانِ زِنَاهُمَ الْإِسْتِمَاعِ. And as for the two ears, their fornication is listening to haram. واللسان زناه الكلام. And as for the tongue, then its fornication is speaking. واليد زناها البطش. And as for the hand, then its zina, its fornication is to touch. والرجل زناها الخطى. As for the feet, their zina is to walk. والقلب يهوى ويتمنى ويصدق ذلك الفرج ويكذبه. And as for the heart, then it desires and it wants and it craves. And the private parts of this person either affirm this or they negate this. Whenever we look at something haram, this is the zina of our eyes. Whenever we hear talk about haram that is related to this, then this is the zina of our ears. If we touch a woman, then this is the zina of our hands. If we walk towards haram, if we walk towards zina, or if we walk towards something to take a look at something, this is the zina of the feet. If we speak about haram and what you are going to do in terms of zina, then this is the zina of the tongue. And the heart, it absorbs all of this, and then it craves the zina. And the private parts affirm this, so the person, he goes out and he commits zina. And this is how shaitan attacks the believers. If we look at the situation and the affairs of the Salaf, the pious predecessors, and how they controlled their gaze, we'll find an example in front of us. We have Hassan ibn Abi Sinan, rahimahullah ta'ala. On the day of Eid, he went out to perform the Eid Salah. And then he returned. And his wife, she said to him, كم من امرأة جميلة رأيت اليوم? How many beautiful women did you see today? So he said, أعوذ بالله. I seek refuge in Allah from this. Then his wife, she said to him, how many women did you see that had great adornments, that adorned themselves? How many of them did you see today? So he said to his wife, that be quiet. Do not mention these things in front of me. Because wallahi, from the time that I left my house until I returned, I didn't look at anything except for my two feet. For his entire journey, and his entire journey when he returned home, the only thing that he looked at was his two feet. This keeps a person away from looking at the opposite gender. This keeps a person away from looking at haram. This keeps a person away from temptations. This keeps the person away from this disease of the heart. That he lowers his gaze, and he looks at his feet for the entire journey. So his gaze does not slip, and he does not look at a woman intentionally or unintentionally. We also have the example of Muhammad ibn Wasi' rahimahullah ta'ala. He used to go to the house of his friend, and he used to knock on the door. And his friend used to have a slave girl, a young slave girl who used to open the door. So Muhammad ibn Wasi', every time he used to knock on the door, he used to close his eyes. So she would see him, and she would say to him, what do you want? He said, I want to talk to so-and-so, her master. So she would go to her master, and she would say to her master, oh master, someone has come to see you. So he would say, who is this? He said, it is your blind friend, the one who comes to this house every day. She thought he was blind because he would never open his eyes. This is how they would act and implement the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Say to the believers, lower your gazes. This is how they would implement the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a story mentioned by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala in his kitab al-Jawab al-Kafi. He says there was a muazzin. There was a caller, the one who calls the adhan, a muazzin. He went on top of the masjid one day to call the adhan. So he began to call the adhan. When he said hayya ala salah and hayya ala al-falah, he turned his head to the right and he turned his head to the left. And he saw a young woman in a garden, in one of the houses that were close to the masjid. Just this one gaze. He saw this young woman who was in a garden, in one of the houses close to the masjid. So when he completed the adhan, or it wasn't mentioned whether he completed the adhan or not, he went to the house of this woman and he knocked on the door. So a Christian woman, she came out. And she said, what do you want? He said, I want to either marry you in a halal way, or have relationship with you in a haram way, or do whatever you wish. This is how much that one gaze affected his heart. So she said to him, I cannot do anything with you until you seek the permission of my father. But my father is not home right now, so come back after sunset and speak to my father. So this man, he left. And he returned after sunset and he knocked on the door and the girl's father opened the door. And he said to him, I want to take your daughter's hand in marriage. He said, which religion are you upon? He said, I am a Muslim. He said, she is a Christian. And the only way I will give you her hand in marriage to you is if you become a Christian. So he said to her, he said to him, what do I have to say? Say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثُ. Say that Allah is a third of three, like the Trinity. So this man, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a third of three. So then the father, he gave him a cross to wear. So he put the cross around his neck. So the cross was hanging on his chest. Instantly he changed his religion. Then he said to the father, when can I meet your daughter? He said, come to me later tonight so you can meet my daughter. So this man, he ascended a building to overlook something. And he fell off the building and he died. Before he met the woman. He died. And he changed his religion. And he died with the cross pressed against his chest. For what? It all began with this one gaze. And how did this gaze begin? While he was doing an ibadah. While he was calling the adhan. He was calling the adhan and his gaze slipped during the adhan and he looked at the woman. But he didn't turn immediately. So he was able to see the woman and analyze the woman. Because he did not turn his gaze immediately. So because of that single gaze, he left the adhan, he approached the woman, he left his religion, and he enters Jahannam. And this is mentioned by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah in al-Jawab al-Kafi. If we think about our eyesight, this is a blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. How many people that we see that are blind? And how they struggle to live in this dunya? This is a ni'mah that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given to us in this dunya. Are we going to use the bounties that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given us to disobey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is one of the greatest blessings that Allah has given us. One of the greatest blessings that He's allowed us to see. And are we going to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the blessing that He has given us? When a person looks at the opposite gender and he looks at something haram, remember when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Yawm al-Qiyamah, what are you going to say to Him for the haram that you have done with the mercy and the bounty that He has given you? You will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He will say to you, what have you done with your eyes? What did you do with your hands? What did you do with your feet? What did you do with your body? What did you do with your private parts? And if you think that you're going to lie in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will close your mouth and your hands will begin to speak and your feet will begin to speak. And your body will begin to speak. And there is no lying in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single part of you will speak and testify the haram that you have done. And your eyes will say that I looked at this and I looked at that. Imagine now. Subhanallah, imagine if you were to take our eyes and we were to act as if our eyes is a video camera. And it records everything that we see. So whatever we see, it will be played in front of the entire creation. And everyone will see what you saw. Would you ever look at anything haram? Why? Because you know the creation will see this haram that you have seen. But do you not think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees what you see? Do you not think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything that we see? And we will be brought in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we'll be questioned in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of the haram that we have done. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He said in the Quran, يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows the fraud of our eyes and that which our hearts conceal. Why does He mention the fraud of our eyes? Ibn Abbas radiallahu an, he says in the explanation of this verse, this is like a man who enters a house and there is a beautiful girl in that house and her parents and her family are present in that house. So whenever her parents are looking at him, he's looking down. But as soon as he sees that her parents' gazes have turned from him, he looks at the girl. Then when he finds that the parents look at him again, he lowers his gaze. So the parents believe that he is only lowering his gaze. But he is deceiving them. And he is really looking at their daughter. This is the fraud of the eyes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything that we look at. So remember, every single time we look at something that is haram, just remind yourself. That what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to say to me? Or what am I going to say to Allah Jalla wa Ala when I meet Him? How am I going to answer for this haram that I have done? Because Allah Jalla wa Ala knows everything that we are doing. And remember, we will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will speak directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He will speak directly to us subhanahu wa ta'ala. As mentioned in the hadith, no one will be there to translate anything. We'll have no interpreters, nothing. It would be us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will have to answer for everything that we have done. As we have seen in the previous story mentioned by Ibn al-Qayyim, that a single gaze can lead a person to eternity in Jahannam. Because a single gaze could lead to something which is haram. And that could lead to a person leaving Islam and accepting another religion. As has been mentioned by some of the scholars of Seerah, there was a man, he was fighting in jihad against the enemy. And while he was fighting in jihad against the enemy, he saw that there was a beautiful woman on the side. So he approached this woman and he said to her that I want to commit zina with you. She said that you are fighting an army that my brother is part of. And you are not upon the same religion as me. So you will never come and you will never touch me and bring your hands close to me. So he said, what religion are you upon? So she said, I am upon the religion of Christianity. So he accepted Christianity. Then she said, this is not enough. Those people are killing my brother and they are killing my family. You have to defend us. So he joined the army that he was initially fighting until he died against the Muslims. Look at this. A single gaze that led to him changing his religion, that led to him fighting the Muslims. This is from the works of Shaytan. And this is why zina and not lowering the gazes is from one of the most harmful diseases of the heart. And this could lead to a person's eternity in Jahannam if he changes his religion because of his desire. Now a person, he needs to continuously remind himself of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he needs to continuously remind himself of the Akhirah. That is it worth it to look at something haram for a minute or two and then to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this haram? How would a person feel if, subhanallah, none of us can guarantee that we will be Muslims tomorrow? None of us could guarantee that we are going to die as Muslims. And the more haram we do in this dunya, the more less likely this could become. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to say, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O changer of hearts, make my heart firm on your religion. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Make my heart firm on your religion. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the hearts of the believers are between the two fingers from the fingers of Ar-Rahman. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He changes them however He wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We could be Muslims or we could die as kuffar. Or we could be kuffar or we could die as Muslims. It is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, depending on how our iman is. If we are sincere with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will die as Muslims. And if we are not sincere with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will die as kuffar. This disease is one of the things that leads to a person leaving his religion. It leads to eternity in Jahannam. Or it could lead to great punishment in Jahannam. Because it could lead to zina. And zina is from the major sins. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to punish you for this, then He would punish you for this. From a single gaze, that could subhanallah lead to something which is greater than drinking alcohol. A single gaze could lead to something which is greater than dealing with interest. And that is zina. Many of us have relatives. Many of us go to college or university and we see the opposite gender every day. How do we act towards them? Are we supposed to sit with them and talk to them and look at them? And we think, no, she's only my friend. I'm not going to increase in desire for her. Now, this is how the shaitan, he works. She's only someone in your class. She's only someone that sits on your table. She's only someone that you have to go to a house because you have to do coursework together. She's only your friend, you can touch her hand. And then she's your friend that you can commit zina with. And then she's your friend who you can go to Jahannam with. This is how the shaitan works. Touching the woman is haram. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in the hadith, collected by Tabarani, that it's better for one of us to put an iron rod, an iron needle into our heads, than to just touch the hand of a woman. just to touch the hand of a woman. It's better for any of us to put an iron needle or an iron rod into our head than to touch just the hand of a woman. So what about touching the body of a woman or committing zina with the woman? If this is haram, just to touch the hand of a woman, and it's worse and it's better for you to put an iron rod into your head, then what about going to a woman's house or speaking to her privately or speaking to her with desire or even just looking at her? All of this is haram, and all of this would lead a person to Jahannam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we can reiterate the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there is nothing more harmful to the men than women. ما تركت بعدي فتنة أدر على الرجال من النساء. I haven't left a single trial, or there is no single trial and tribulation that is left that is more harmful to men than women. That wallahi, if you allow your desires to overtake you, then the shaitan has full control over you. And if the shaitan has full control over you, then he can make you switch your religion just like this, as he did with these people that I mentioned. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions a great hadith in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, from the hadith of Samura ibn Jundub radiyallahu an. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went to sleep and he saw something in his dream. And the dreams of the prophets are revelation. In his dream, he saw two angels coming to him, and they took him to the heavens, and they showed him different punishments for different crimes. So they took him to different places, and then they moved him to the next place and the place after. And to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came across a place. He said, "Ila thaqbin mithla tannur." He came to a hole, and he saw a hole in front of him, which was like a massive oven. The top of this oven was narrow, and the bottom of this oven was wide. And there was fire at the bottom of this oven, boiling that which was inside it. He said there were things inside this oven that they would raise when the fire raises, and they would go down when the fire goes down. And he said this was full of men and women. So then he asked the angels, he said, "What is this that you have shown me?" They said, "Proceed." So the Prophet ﷺ proceeded until he saw the other things. Then the angels began to describe everything to him and explain what was what. So when they came upon this, they said, "Do you remember those people that were burning in the oven?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Yes, I remember." They say, "وَالَّذِي رَأَيْتَهُ فِي الثَّقْبٍ فَهُمُ الزُّنَى." Those who you saw that were in that hole, they were those who committed adultery and fornication. They were those who committed adultery and fornication. These are those who will be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person has to avoid everything that is haram. And everything that would take us to Jahannam is haram. Everything that leads to zina is haram. The gaze is haram. The gaze is haram. And everything else after the gaze which leads to zina is haram. And the brother said, "Can you please come closer, inshallah? Because we're blocking the entrance. So please, inshallah ta'ala, come closer." So the gaze is haram, and everything else which leads to zina is haram. Many of us have relatives, cousins, that we are not allowed to sit with in the same room, that we are not allowed to speak to, or that we are not allowed to look towards. But we think because they are cousins, they are like our sisters. But no, this is haram for us to look at them. It is haram for us to touch them. It is haram for us to be in seclusion with them. And this is some of the things that will lead us to Jahannam. Many of us, we live in the same houses as our brothers, and they are married, and we think that we can talk to their wives. This is also something that will lead us to Jahannam. All of these things are haram. It is not permissible for a man to speak or to look at any other woman that is not from his family, his immediate family, like his mothers or his sisters or his daughters or his grandmothers or his paternal or his maternal aunties, and no one else. He's not allowed to look at his cousin. He's not allowed to look at the wife of his uncle. He's not allowed to look at the wife of his brother. He's not allowed to, or she is not allowed to look at the husband of her sister. All of this is haram. And all of this leads to Jahannam. The shaitan will come and he will place that first black dot into your heart. Then he will place that second black dot into your heart. And then he would leave you, because he knows there are enough black dots in your heart so you never turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we say, how can we increase our iman so we stay away from this haram? Remind yourself of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the scholars, they say, do not think about how small the sins that we are doing are. But think about how great Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Do not think about how small the sins that we are doing. Because you may say it's only a glance. It's only a look. It's something small. But do not think about how small this is. But think about the greatness of the one who you are disobeying when you are committing this, when you are committing this sin. That you will have to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you have passed away, there is nothing in front of you except for Jannah and Jahannam. Are your actions good enough for Jannah? Have you committed enough good deeds for Jannah? Or have you committed enough sins for the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take you to Jahannam? Have we purified our hearts? Have we recited enough Qur'an to purify our hearts? As Allah Jalla wa Ala, He says in the Qur'an, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهِ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُمْ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ That the believers, they are those that if the Qur'an is recited to them, زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا Their iman increases, their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases. Their certainty about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهِ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned, their hearts begin to tremble. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ And if the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioned, زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا Their iman increases and they only rely upon their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more deeds we do, the harder it becomes for us to commit haram. There's a story mentioned by Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala. And he mentions a pious man. He says, there was a man who used to fast throughout the day. And he used to pray qiyamul layl throughout the night. He never used to involve himself in anything that was haram. He knew that the people that were around him in his land were corrupt people. So he didn't sit in the gatherings because all they used to do was backbite and slander. So he stayed away from any gatherings. And he would just stay in his house and never leave his house. When he ran out of food, he would leave his house and he would store and he would buy enough food to last him as long as it can. And then he would remain in his house just worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people of the land, they gathered together. And they said, look at this man. Does he think that he is better than us? He doesn't come and sit in our gatherings. He doesn't walk around or talk to us. We just see him and he looks down on the floor and he goes to the shop and he goes back to his house. Never did this man look right or left or even in front of him. He would just look down and walk. So the people became jealous of this man. And this is how they work. Shaitan doesn't just attack you by himself, but Shaitan has people that he has and he inspires his haram into them and he commands them to attack the believers. So this is what they did. So what they did was they looked around the land until they found the most beautiful woman in that land. And she was a young woman. And she was a chaste woman. And they approached her. And they said, we want you to seduce that man. And we want you to commit zina with that man. So she said, how can I do such a thing? And she was from amongst the most poorest women in that land. She found it very difficult to live. So they said to her, if you can do this, then we will give you the equivalent to your weight in gold. And even more than this. And all of this poverty that you are facing today, it will end. All you have to do is commit zina with that man. So the woman, she went home and she thought and she began to think. Until she looked at her situation and she thought, subhanAllah, or she thought to herself that there is nothing left for me. I'm going to die of poverty and I have nothing left. So she accepted the task that they had given her. And she said, I will go and I will commit zina with this man. So one cold night, she went and she knocked on the house of this man. She knocked on the door of the house of this man. So he opened the door and he saw a woman. So he closed the door. So she raised her voice and she said, please allow me to come into your house. I was traveling and I thought that I would reach my destination before night. But now, the night has come and I'm in the middle of nowhere and I do not know where I am. I do not know anyone in this land. And if you do not accept me into your house, then I fear that something will happen to me outside. So he said, we have many neighbors around. From the door, please go and knock on the house of these neighbors and inshallah ta'ala, they will help you. So the woman, she left. A little while later, she knocked on his door again. And she said, I went to the houses of your neighbors, but no one is home. And it is really cold outside. And I fear that I may die if you do not accept me and allow me to come into your house. So he said, just go further down the hills and you'll find that there are a few more houses over there. And inshallah ta'ala, they will allow you to live with them. He said, there is no one in my house. So it's not permissible for you to be with me. So the woman, she left. A little while later, she came back again. And she knocked on his door. So he opened the door and he saw the woman. And she said, Wallahi, if you do not allow me to come into your house, and if any man, he puts his finger on me, and he rapes me, and he takes away my chastity, then Wallahi, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, I will stand in front of Allah and say, you were the one who was the cause of this. It is because of you, he raped me. It is because of you, this happened. And I will blame it on you. And when he heard the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he became really scared. Why? Because إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهِ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Because the believers, when the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned, their hearts begin to tremble. So this man, he became really scared. So he said, and he had two rooms in his house. So he said to her, he said, come and sit in this room. And do not knock on my door, and do not say anything to me. As soon as the time of Fajr approaches, leave my house and continue with your journey. So the man, he left this woman in this room, and he went into the second room that he had, and he locked the door. And he continued with his recitation of Quran. Now the people of the land, they know that she has entered his house. So they have gathered around the house, waiting to catch the two of them committing zina. And this is a pious man. And he has never faced anything like this in his life. So he is in his house now, and he is reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this woman is ready to commit zina with this man. And the people of the land have gathered around the house, waiting to enter the house to catch them committing zina. The man now, he's reciting Quran. And the woman, she begins to scream. She screams and she screams and she screams. So the man, he opens his door and he walks into the room where the woman is. He has an oil lamp with him. And he walks into the room where the woman is. Only to find that she is lying on the floor without her clothes on. And she is calling him towards her. This man now, for the first time in his life, he is seeing something that he has never seen before. Because his gaze has always been lowered. He is feeling something in his heart now that he has never felt before. His mind is telling him things that he has never told him before. He has the most beautiful woman of the land in front of him, calling him for zina. What does he do? What would a person in this situation do? He has never seen anything like this in his life. The people now, they know. They heard the first scream from the woman. So they know that very soon, they will catch them committing zina. So they come closer to the door of the house of the man. The woman now, all of a sudden, begins to scream. And she screams and she continues to scream and scream and scream. The people of the land, they break down the door of this man, the door of the house of this man. And they enter to find that the woman is on the floor. And the man is also on the floor. But the woman is in one side of the room. And the man is in the other side of the room. And the woman continues to scream. And she continues to scream. They look at the man and he is crying in the corner of the room. And his hand is in the fire of the lamp that he has. And he is crying and he is crying. And the woman is screaming. So they take the woman out of the house. And she says, take me away from this man. Because wallahi, the iman of this man is killing me. I see something in front of me that I cannot describe. And this has done something to my heart and my mind. The iman of this man is killing me, so take me away. And the man is crying in the corner. Because every single time the man, he took a step towards the woman, he put his hand in the fire that he had. And he said, remember, the fire of Jahannam is hotter than the fire of this dunya. Until he would fall to the floor. And then, when he was able to stand up again, he would stand up again and take a step towards the woman. And when he took a step towards the woman again, he would put his hand back in the fire and say, remember, the fire of Jahannam is more severe than the fire of this dunya. And he kept on doing this until his hand was left inside the fire. And the woman began to scream as she was taken away. Then this man, he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, "Oh Allah, forgive me for the sin that I have committed." What sin did this man commit? What did he do? He stayed away from zina. He stayed away from the most beautiful woman of the land. What sin did he commit? He said, "Oh Allah, forgive me for the footsteps I took towards that woman." Look at the iman of this man. Look at the iman of the righteous people. Nothing will tempt them. Nothing will take them away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith I mentioned, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put enough white dots in the heart of the person, it will automatically repel evil. And it will automatically repel haram. So a person, he has to strive to increase his iman. He has to strive to increase his love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when a person truly loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing can stand between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would build this taqwa, this barrier between him and anything that raves the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the scholars say, the definition of taqwa, أن تجعل بينك وبين عذاب الله وقاية, to make between you and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a barrier. The more a person fasts, the stronger his taqwa will become, the stronger his barrier would become. As Allah Jalla wa Ala, he says in the Quran, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Oh you who believe, fasting has been prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you, so that you may be from those who have taqwa. So fasting increases taqwa. It increases the barrier between us and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It increases the barrier between us and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It increases the barrier between us and the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For those who are not married, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given you an advice. And he says, من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج فإنه أغض للبصر وأحسن للفرج. Whoever of you is able to get married, then get married. If you find it hard to be single, whoever of you is able to get married, then get married. Because this will help you lower your gaze and protect your private parts. ومن لم يستطع فعليه الصوم فعليه بالصوم فإنه له وجاء. And whoever is unable to get married, then he must fast. Because fasting is a shield. Fasting is a shield. And this shield increases your taqwa. And this taqwa increases your barrier between you and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this increases your chances of going into Jannah. And this increases your chances of staying away from every haram. So those who are not married, if you are able to get married, then get married. And if you are unable to get married, then fast. Because if you fast, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you from this disease of the heart. Will protect you from the fitna and the temptations of women. Remember, just keep reminding yourself of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Keep reminding yourself of Jahannam. And if you find it difficult, then just put your hand over a flame of fire and see what happens to your hand. You would move your hand instantly. And remember the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the fire of Jahannam is 70 times hotter than the hottest fire of the dunya. The fire that we have on the fire that we see, like on the cookers or on the stoves, it's not the hottest fire of the dunya. The fire that we see that comes out of the volcanoes, this is probably also not the hottest fire of the dunya. But if we were to go near this, this would burn us. The fire of Jahannam is 70 times hotter than the hottest fire of this dunya. The Sahaba, they said, Ya Rasulullah, in kana la kafiya, if it was just the same as the dunya, it would have been sufficient. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has increased this to torture and torment those who disobeyed him subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who turned away from his command, those who turned away from his religion. So those who find the temptation of women a great fitna, then make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he allows you to get married. And if you cannot get married now, then fast and pray Qiyamul Layl and recite the Quran. There was a person, there was a pious man, And he was living with a person, like his roommate, his flatmate. Whether this was in university or somewhere else, he was living with someone. And this person wasn't a practicing person. He had many women that would come to visit him in his house, and he would commit zina with women. But he was living with a pious person. And this person, he entered the house one day, and he recited his Quran and then he left. So his roommate, he said, look at this person, how good he is. We want to allow him to taste some of this dunya. You're only going to be in this dunya once. Let him live this dunya and enjoy this dunya. So he called two of his friends over, which were girls, which were women. They came to his house, and they were two beautiful women. And they came to this house, and they were sitting in the house. The man, he entered the house, and he sat down on the chair, not knowing the women were in the house. The two women, they approached this man, and they sat next to him. He stood up instantly and he walked away. And they said, where are you going? We've only come to you to talk to you. This man now, he began to feel the desire for women in his heart. The desire for women increased in his heart. The women, they approached him and they came close to him. And they said, we only want to sit with you and talk with you. So the man, he entered his room and he locked the door. This person, out of this desire he's feeling in his heart, as Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions, when you feel this desire in your heart, it makes you crazy. You do not think about consequences. You do not think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not think about the fire of Jahannam. The only thing you think about is how to satisfy this desire. So this desire is making this man crazy. He's inside his room and he's crouched on the floor, rolling around, not knowing what to do. And the women are on the other side of the door, saying things to him, calling him out to them. And the man is becoming crazy. He doesn't know what to do. He looks around in his room and he sees the Quran. He looks around in his room and he sees the Quran. He said, these are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He opens the Quran and the first ayah he reads is about the Hurul Ain. The first ayah he reads is about the Hurul Ain, about the women of Jannah. As soon as he read about the Hurul Ain, he forgot about everything that was outside the room. He forgot about those women who were calling him. Because he said to himself, Allah Jalla wa Ala has prepared something which no eye has seen. And no one has touched. And the mind of no man can conceive. These are women in Jannah that no man has ever touched. No man has ever looked at. And the Hurul Ain that you will get, no man will ever see. But they will be exclusive just for you. And these are the women of Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ mentions, if their fragrance was to touch the earth, every single person from the creation would turn to the fragrance. Alim, not an alim, a normal person, however pious you are, just their fragrance. These are the women of Jannah that Allah Jalla wa Ala has prepared for the believers. Think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Jannah. Think about the Hurul Ain. The Hurul Ain of Jannah. The women of Jannah. And you will forget everything of this dunya. And when you marry women in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them more beautiful than the Hurul Ain of Jannah. So get married as well in this dunya. But imagine what you have in Jannah. This is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we have to work towards this Jannah. And the more we increase our iman, the easier it will be for us to repel this haram, to repel this temptation, to repel the whispering of the shayateen. So brothers and sisters, I advise myself and all of you to read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have a portion of the Quran that you recite every day. And this will change your life. Read the translation of the Quran. Know what Allah Jalla wa Ala has to say to you. And this will change your life. Every day just read a few pages of Quran. If you spent just 20 minutes a day on Quran, just to read Quran, how much Quran would we read? Why is it that we only finish Quran in Ramadan? And some of us do not even finish the Quran in Ramadan. But Allah Jalla wa Ala gave us this Quran as a reminder, as a wake-up call, to protect us from haram and to allow us to do good deeds to enter His Jannah. Reading Quran is an ibadah. Reading Quran will increase our iman. Fast during the day if you are able to do so. Pray Qiyamul Layl during the evenings if you are able to do so. Pray the sunnahs of the day. Move your tongue in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do whatever you can to increase your iman. Because increasing iman is done by in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you increase in your iman. And whenever you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you decrease in your iman. And the more iman you have, the harder it would be for you to go into haram. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instills this love for the religion in your heart. He instills the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart. And when you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how are you able to disobey Him? Because you love Him. You reach this level of love that you would only think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything you do is only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the highest level after iman. When a person perfects his iman, then he reaches the level of ihsan. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he asked Jibreel about ihsan, he said, "أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك." That you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you see Him. But yet you do not see Allah, but know that Allah jalla wa ala sees you. Imagine if you were to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How would you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If you were able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how would you worship Him? You know that He is always there because you can see Him. So you would never disobey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So know that Allah jalla wa ala, He sees you wherever you are. So continuously worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we have this mindset that we know that Allah jalla wa ala is watching us, every single second of our life, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching us. Every single thing that we are doing, He knows what we are doing. And He's watching us. And the angels are recording and writing every single thing down. This will make you aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the only thing you want to do is please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance for what we have done. And we do good actions to please Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah jalla wa ala is the most merciful. He loves it when a slave, he turns to Allah in repentance. He loves it when we raise our hands and we ask Allah, say, "Oh Allah, forgive me." To the extent that Allah jalla wa ala, it says in the hadith, that there are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if there are people that do not turn to Allah in repentance, or there are people that do not commit sins, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create a people that commit sins only so they can ask for forgiveness so Allah can forgive them. This is how much Allah jalla wa ala loves to forgive His slaves. That if no one was asking for forgiveness and no one was committing sins, Allah jalla wa ala will create a people so they can commit sins, so they can ask Allah to forgive them, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. Every single one of us know the haram that we do. Every single one of us know how we have disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we do in our private time and what we do publicly. Every single one of us know this. And we all know that Allah jalla wa ala knows this. And we all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to remind us of this in Yawm al-Qiyamah. If we do not ask for forgiveness, all it takes is a few minutes of our time. Raise your hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First, leave the sin that you are doing. Regret that which you have done. Promise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you would never do this haram again. And sincerely ask for His forgiveness. And you will find that in Yawm al-Qiyamah, you will only find deeds and no sins. Because if you ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to forgive you for every single sin that you have done, and you are sincere, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive every single sin that you have done. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's easy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do this. So turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. Make dua when you are in sajda. Make dua when you are by yourself and no one can see you. Because the best dua is a dua where no one can see you. This is when you raise your hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you cry. And no one can see you because there's no showing off here. There's no pride and arrogance here. It's only between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like Zakariya, when he made the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made a dua and Allah said it was a secret dua. إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ نِدَاءً خَفِيًّا. When he made dua, when he called to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a secret calling, a calling in private that no one was able to see and no one was able to hear except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did Allah Jalla wa'ala do? He blessed him with Yahya, a child. He was asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this. Continuously make istighfar. While you are walking, just say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. While you are walking, say subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim. While you are walking, say la ilaha illallah. All of this increases your iman. Because you are saying this, and these are good deeds that brings you closer to Allah. And this is all things that you are doing in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And obedience increases you in iman. So we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows us to increase in our iman. That He allows us to enjoin in the good and forbid the evil. That He allows us to worship Him throughout the day and throughout the night. Allows us to fast throughout the day. And He allows us to worship Him in salah throughout the night. And He allows us to clean our hearts completely and remove every disease that is within our hearts and to make our hearts completely white with iman. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت وأستغفرك وأتوب إليك وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.